kind of.
Oh, I'm sorry, they're supposed to have left the key for us.
Yes. No, that's fine.
So, I'm Ethan. Good to see you again.
Yes, you too. Steve.
Good to see you.
This is my wife, Missy.
Hi, Missy. How are you?
Some of my kids here.
So, you got three kids?
We actually have four.
Okay.
One's not here.
How are you, man?
Fine, I'm your mother.
Okay, I'm Ethan. Nice to meet you.
We gotta get the guy on my other dad. Let me take a picture of it.
Hey, Richard.
I got it.
The key is not where it was supposed to be, so yet we're waiting on staff to come up here and unlock for us. He told me to be right here.
This guy jumps fences and goes through gates all the time. He's not supposed to. He can't get you in. Well, it's a headstone. That doesn't mean there's a body.
Yes, to my
mind.
No, I can see you. I just can't see your face. I can see the back of
your
head.
I can see you.
Where's that?
Down on Morgan's site.
Not really.
Never seen him. Very
bad. Here you go. Ow. Oh, Daddy.
Yesterday, some lady in the
I've never in my life had this much trouble getting into this building.
Every digital watch, you punch in a code if you had a building rented or whatever, or reserved.
This is one of the few that doesn't have a numerical keypad.
That's two, there's two inch common sensor right here.
Oh well, everybody's finally got over all the crud. Speaking of which, excuse me a sec. Hello? Hey.
Yeah.
We go over there? Okay.
National's out.
exactly right.
If y'all wouldn't mind signing in.
We have to report to you all.
Been waiting? Just note that they're not here.
Okay,
but yeah, I'm happy.
It's okay.
Saturday, right?
That's the
time. Nine.
Three.
So, and have
right on these lines?
Yeah, it's okay.
Make sure you put it right there.
No, this, yeah, I know I've been.
I'm hitting people that haven't been
slacking so far.
I know.
That's the survey. This is the site.
We're going over here.
How far away is it?
It's at Chattahoochee River Farm, which is down at.
Oh, yeah. Okay. It's going to be tight. I mean, it's just if I'm playing one of the later lines, this is already goes fast.
Okay.
importantly, we can't have net field. We can't go in there and start building it. If we do disturb it, we have to make a check somewhere else.
Right, so if it won't go from here, where this house is checking
this
floodplain, I'll have that flood.
Well, that'll, yeah, we'll turn that. These houses won't be rectangles. So that will just
the tops. In other words, that's just the lot area where we tend to build.
Let's spend some time talking about this.
Okay.
Because flat out, I don't believe you, right? Because if this is a floodplain that's designated by FEMA, I'm going to do the same thing on 5 acres in Candy Springs.
Okay.
There is a requirement. You cannot build it.
Okay?
We know so you can build it. We
can build it. You can't even put, there's a setback. So let's talk about it later on. This is, I don't see how you can possibly justify this. But let's
we've talked about this before, but we'll circle back to it. You're in the ALC.
Okay. Where would be the best place for everybody to sit? I want to make sure people can see us over here. Inside would be nice. So, we'll go ahead and get started. Thank y'all for coming. Some of y'all coming back. This is some of our second meeting. And then other folks, this will be your first meeting. My name's Ethan Underwood. I'm with the Lipscomb Johnson firm. We're working with United Family Homes, working to navigate the zoning process on this application. This is Richard Breedlove. He's our engineer. And Caleb, I always mispronounce your last name.
McGahey
is our surveyor engineer as well. So we wanted to get back with y'all, circle back. I'm trying to just remember everyone. Who all is this? Is the first time you didn't make it to the first meeting? Okay. All right. We'll give you a brief synopsis, and then we're here to answer questions and try to get y'all as comfortable as you can with the application. Since the original application, we've modified the site plan slightly. The original tract didn't show the northern portion of the property. It did show the area which is going to be developed. So the site plan's been revised and resubmitted for Forsyth County in accordance with the code. So this site plan, nothing has changed in this area. It just shows the entire acreage on top of it. What we're asking for is 24 lots. What's the total acreage on this? 25.04, so it's coming in just under an acre, one lot per acre. It's a res 3 developments that are coming in. The lots are, they're smaller lots, but they're commensurate with the lots that are in Westbrook, as y'all know, which is zone PUD.
It no longer exists,
but again, we're trying to be comfortable what's in the area. When we last met, we heard several concerns, obviously home quality, drainage, and I think we're going to get talking about more. We have developed some zoning conditions that we're willing to agree to. I think some of the concerns that were raised, forgive me, since we moved locations in a little out of order here.
Mr. Breedlove, do you work directly with the builder, or are you an engineer that's been hired to help with the drawings and whatnot?
I've been hired. Well, he's representing a builder, and I'm hired through him.
Okay. So you aren't with the developer, so to speak?
No, I have no ownership. I'm just a subcontractor.
Is it customary for there not to be any sort of developer's representative at these meetings?
Well, we're the representative. So I'm their attorney. We can bind them.
But someone that can answer questions about the typical home that they build, the finishes, mm-hmm. the elevations, things like that. That's what was specifically asked for at the last meeting.
Sometimes they come, sometimes they don't. Gotcha. They're not here to see them. But what we can do is put forward to you, I think one of the things that was concerned was whether there be any buffering along the boundary of the property. It's not required by code because this is not 50 acres, but we can put in a 25-foot landscape buffer along the perimeter. To be candid with you, the topography on this site is pretty steep. It's going to require some grading. So it will take grading on the site, but what we can do is replant a buffer it'll take 2-3 years to grow up and provide the full screening that makes it visually impervious. But we can plant something back to county requirements, which requires at least 2 rows of evergreen plantings, 3 different trees. So that would be planted in a 25-foot buffer along the perimeter there.
So just to be clear, all the trees all the way to the property line can be taken down.
They can be.
Mm-hmm. And they most likely will. Because you can't, it's seriously? So with this type of topography, you can't, you're telling me you don't need every grain of sand, every grain of dirt you need to level off that? You're going to need to go all the way to the Westbrook property line to get the dirt that you need, correct?
I don't know.
It's possible.
Is there a grading plan?
No, sir.
When will that be developed?
After zoning. Once you zone it, then it goes into the technical requirements of the full engineering of the site.
The tree replacement for Forsyth County is pretty strict, so we don't want to take down any trees if we don't have to.
I think ours, one of the main things is they're going to redo the topography of this whole area. So how is that going to affect?
Well, we're not going to redo any more than we have to because that would mess up the natural drainage patterns.
That's what everyone's saying about all these developments. And there's lots of examples of development of bulldozers that are running as we speak.
Sure.
Where they, I'm sure we're told the exact same thing about we don't want to cut down more trees than we have to because then we have to put back more trees.
Right, it costs more for the developer.
I hear you saying that. You said the exact same thing last time. Mm-hmm. Yet, on all these developments, every tree's being taken down. Oops, didn't get the memo. We're taking them all down. So that's
trying.
This is one reason we bought the home, is just that beautiful view at the back.
And I understand that, but these folks, you can't base your view and your property value on somebody else's property. I mean, this is somebody else who owns it. They pay taxes on it. And they can develop it just like the folks in Westbrook developed that property. But what we want to try to do is work with y'all and preserve what we can, preserve your privacy. And maintain high quality so it's not affecting anybody's property. But it's different. It'll be different than what's there now.
But they don't own it currently. They do not own it. They have
no,
a contract.
I was incorrect when we last met. No, it's under contract.
Right. Yeah, of course, contract contingent on getting the zoning, mm-hmm. Correct?
That's correct.
Right. When you say, because that land, you said, as you said, is very steep, right? Especially as it gets closer and closer to the Westbrook neighborhood side, right?
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that you are going to have to regrade some of it because it's impossible to. It's just too steep. What are you going to do to ensure that there's not erosion and other things from the into the Westbrook home? Because my backyard goes like this, and I have a fence and I have a wall there. You're going to have to do something similar, right? What are your plans for
right,
that?
I mean, we'll capture all the stormwater runoff that we can. Conversions. We'll have all the storm limits, piping that we need to keep it off the surface. Anywhere it does hit the surface, we'll have it fully stabilized.
I guess alongside that same question, so again, I keep coming back to this. Starting right around here, mm-hmm. About 37, mm-hmm. The severe drop off. I mean, from this all the way over down the pass. Yeah, it's
severe.
Significantly lower than the rest. And so if you're saying you're going to grade that up.
This has the topo.
Yes. All right, so I'm talking about right here is kind of a high, and then it just drops.
Right, that's the rear stream. Yep. And then it gets a little bit concentrated in the back.
Yeah.
It goes diagonal.
Like right here. Uh-huh. Yep. Yeah.
So, again, during the storm, I see like ravines of water just running down mm-hmm. to the creek. Mm-hmm. If you're elevating that and basically blocking that path, where's all that going to go?
It'll be routed around here.
Okay. How's it going to be routed around? I mean, you basically have this house going almost to the corner of the 50-foot setback.
Right, we'll just have a swell.
For what? Through the setback?
A setback is just a building. You can't put a building in it. It can be graded. It can be shaped in order to make the rainwater go where it's supposed to go.
Which means cut down the trees.
Every tree would have gone.
Every tree.
Yeah, there's no way, right?
There's no way to keep a single tree, no matter how much they dry or cost.
So they get a new ravine back there.
And so you guys are planning on lifting? Is that what I heard?
We can't propose a grade steeper than 2:1, so this existing grade's already steeper than that. So we won't be able to really touch that area anyway. I can't promise where the limits will stop.
So you can't exceed.
But you already have.
Right, so if you've already got a steep, let's say 1:1, you really can't touch it, so it makes no sense. So you just leave it as is. But I can't tell you where that limit is until the grading plan's done and we pick out whatever house products they want to put there. It's like this area, there's no advantage of us whatsoever touching that.
So how are you planning on lifting the homes up in this area then? Because, I mean, it goes down. I mean, they'll run, I mean, it'll go into their house. I mean, there's no way. So you got to do something.
Right, we're proposing, what will set the houses really, we have this road.
Y'all, if we can, let's try to keep it to one question at a time so everybody can get their answers.
Oh, our homes go this way. So it's all the way up.
This gentleman, I think, you were still asking about
this. Yeah, I just want to understand what you're doing with the homes, especially in the areas, because it goes, I mean, it's steep, and all the water, my house is obviously, the water rolls down quite substantially.
The way we would set this is, we would get the new road as close to existing grade as we could, and then these driveways, we wouldn't really want to run those much steeper than 10%. That'll set where this garage is, and then we build a house based on, from that up.
Okay. So then any water
coming towards the house, we would divert it either around the house, and if it were too much water, then we would have storm inlets in the back to catch that. So there's no erosion problem around the house, on the house, or around the house.
Wouldn't the water then, but when you're talking in here, wouldn't the water all congregate? Then what are you going to do about that? You know, because you're saying you're lifting the house, but then...
We would divert the water around the house. We would have, normally what you would have is just gentle swells along the property lines. So we would either run it between the houses, the safest way possible, or we would just bring it around the back of this, which is where it naturally wants to go anyway. We would follow that swell coming right through there.
So are you putting in like a, almost like a sewer to go down and then out, or are you just going to create the land?
Hopefully we just do surface drains. It would look something like this, the way they're kind of off the edge of the park, and they just have a swell there. So hopefully we'll just do that. The more we pipe, the more we have to send to the pond. And the pond's already oversized.
If you weren't finished.
No.
If the total acreage is 26 and change acres?
25
and change acres. What's the acreage of this development?
Right, yeah, I think last time we talked about it, approximately 7, something like that. Because this whole track, this original track that stops here, is 5. It's right at 5.
Yeah, 5.7.
Plus 5. A little tail end of this other purchase of this, mm-hmm. Right? So roughly, just call it 7 acres.
Okay.
Right?
Is there any other development or amenities up in that top part that now we include that top part?
The new map included this. Is there
the county? No, tennis no. Courts. The county asked us to change our. We had this drawing before. The county asked us to change our exhibit so that the entire track, even what we're not touching, will show up on one sheet. That's why they were saying we just redrew this.
So didn't change the exhibit. We just show one property.
Yeah, to show everything right, up here. Right. But the site's not getting touched.
So is it accurate to say that 60% of the total land that's being purchased for this won't be touched, but is going to be rezoned as residential, even though it can't be built on now and can be built on later?
Say that again. You're saying 60% is going to be zoned
rest through.
Yeah.
Correct.
Land that's currently zoned agricultural that can't be built on because it's floodplain is going to be rezoned as residential, even though it still can't be built on, just to satisfy the desired homes per acre.
It will be, yes, it'll all get zoned rest through. That's what the code allows, and as I said last time, fortunately...
That doesn't mean that it's good zoning.
Well, I disagree, because the reason you can't build in it is because the government says you can't build in it. And when government tells you you can't use your land, you have to preserve it for the good of the people, and that's just a taking. So at least this way, Forsyth County gives you some transferable development rights. It says we'll compensate you for not using the property we're telling you can't build it.
Well, no one's saying that land can't be built on. It's just saying that it's not zoned for that. So we're just have questions about why it's being...
No, the whole thing, it'll be zoned rest through the entire track.
It might be.
But the entire track has to be, it'll be classified and subject to the zoning conditions. So when we lock down number of lots, minimum home square footage, exterior building materials, the entire track will be subject to that.
In your experience, when zoning conditions are agreed upon up front, how often are they changed at the 11th hour before development begins?
At the 11th hour?
Well, don't forget about the 11th hour. How often are they changed without all parties being notified and having a...
They're not without all being notified. For example, we did a couple zoning condition amendments in your neighborhood so your neighbors could build a pool. I don't think they ever built it, but y'all got notices of that. In fact, I represented those folks and sent letters out to everybody and worked with the neighbors. So if once it's zoned, you have to have another public... The zoning conditions become part of the zoning. And you have to have another public hearing before you can make any change.
What about the condition, maybe I'm using the wrong word, but what about a concession that's agreed upon, such as just using a 50-foot tree buffer or a 30-foot tree buffer or some arbitrary, some number, and then the grader didn't get the memo, and then someone comes home from work and their entire, it's gone. That agreed upon thing is gone.
That's the liability of the grader. Now, we want to do everything we can. Some stuff we have done in the past. But I don't know that we have any undisturbed buffer.
Technical side, one of the first things they'll do is set tree safe fences,
yeah,
which then get inspected by me and the county inspector before they're allowed to do any work.
That's the point. Any ground can be broken. You have to have an erosion control meeting out there. That'll have to be marked off, demarcated per the plan. So that's something I would be coming and show exactly where that buffer's at. And if the grader goes past it, then yeah, that's it.
They would have to tear the fence down to get past it. So
it's a big, huge orange fence, and I can't miss it. It's not like this big.
You know. So I know you're familiar with the land. Are you're personally familiar with the topography of this land?
Mm-hmm.
So. Given the situation, is it reasonable for there to be any footage of undisturbed, and I'm not talking about two, I'm talking about 10 or 15 or greater, footage of undisturbed buffer from here back?
Even if we were allowed to go over to the property line, we wouldn't, but I don't know what that number would be.
Well, look, so you asking for some type of an undisturbed
buffer? I'm just asking if it's reasonable that, if what you're saying is that you have to have every ounce, every inch of land to build, then that basically tells me that it's not going to be something that's reasonably entertainable.
They won't know that until they do the grading.
And I couldn't give you a number on that. What I was saying about this earlier, though, this is steeper than 2-1. It hurts us to touch this. So we're better off leaving the existing steep land. That makes it easier.
Just here?
But that's mine drops off there. So just to clarify.
Yeah.
So between 38 and 39, both of us have the same thing.
Okay.
Our property drops off significantly down in the steep. Mm-hmm. You're saying you're going to have to raise this up to the grade of the common cul-de-sac, and you're going to have to rely then on the natural topography to route that water around?
Right. We will raise these, and then we'll just tie the grading in. So you'll probably...
Uh-huh. So
I haven't done
trench.
It yet, but just looking at this, right? Well, it'd be a soft swell. It wouldn't be a concentrated flow.
And you would be able to move the trees?
The steeper the slope, the less likely we're to touch any trees or any slope, because it's just harder for us to tie into.
Well, but see, all this is flat. This is low flat, all of this.
Well, this is steep here.
Well, my property's steep, but then it drops down in.
You can see how these lines.
Yeah, I know. It goes diagonal, but the steepest part is my property, and then it's a general swell down to the feet. But there's a huge difference between this and that as far as gradients.
Yeah, this is the steepest part of this whole site, right here, where the lines are closest together.
They are.
Can you explain where the, when you get passed into the HOA property, how the easement to the sewer works?
Who does it, Nick?
How the easement?
Yeah.
It'll just be a 20-foot easement centered on the sewer line. Is that what you're asking?
Well, how do you determine that you have an easement? You said there was.
Why did you choose to go up against here instead of maybe back over here? How did you choose to go for a crossroad?
Right. This is all running pretty much parallel, so we're trying to get there as quick as we can. The longer it takes, the further we have to drop, and then we can't tie in. So if you were doing a development now, if this were coming in today, they would require this, whoever developed this, they would require them to actually set manholes next to the property. Rather deal with that on other projects right now.
So who determines that? Is that the county determines? I mean, you're proposing this because it's cheaper for the developer, but who determines where it goes? How does that work?
Well, we just put it in the closest point we can.
They have an incentive to offer sewer. I mean, there was already an easement that was established by the Westbrook development up to this property.
Is it a blanket easement or is it a recorded easement that shows
it's
a path?
It's a recorded easement.
That's what I'd like to see a copy of.
And another thing that would happen, say we didn't do that and we came too close to the floodplain, we need special permits to get in the floodplain. And
one of those is the hardship saying you have no choice. You had to come here. Well, we do have a choice. So then we would get denied this. The county would force us to tie in what we're proposing.
And so this means cut all these trees down. Yeah, too. So how much
are you going to cut? 10 feet or so. I mean, once we do a tree survey, we can come through and try to dodge those as much as possible. That'll be one of the early parts before we do grading. We do a tree survey, meet with the county arborist, he'll mark certain specimen trees on site, and then each one's worth a certain number of units. And then if we say some trees, if you have to take them down, then you replace it with several other trees to equal those same units. So it really hurts a developer to take any tree down at all.
Let's say you get back here and the water level is like very close. It's common to put sewer in with high water tables?
If you have to.
See, that's kind of our dilemma. I mean, it's like y'all are having to push this in with a lot of things going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of sewer lines, especially when you get to the mains, they'll just follow. They'll follow a creek. That's the whole point. They'll tie in from both sides. A lot of times, if you follow sewer maps, the farther down you go towards the treatment plants, the closer you get to the creeks. So it's common to put them where the ground
is. So how wide is the path to the sewer easement?
The easement's 20 feet. That's okay. The county medicine.
But you don't have to cut 20 feet.
No. But you cannot. What you need is whatever you need to trench. This will be very shallow, so they may trench 5 or 10 feet. That's all they need to get through there.
So in theory, there could be, from here back, there could be a 20-foot wide path.
Theoretically, they could be, and that's what the county says. If we have to come in and rip a line up, we want this much elbow. That doesn't mean that's what you need to install.
And that has to fall, so it has to go down. There was the topography.
Generally, it has to fall, but the sewer line itself has to fall. This topography is very flat.
Yeah, let's speak up so everybody can hear.
Yeah, it does go back up here. And this area is pretty much flat. So the ground does this, and the sewer line under it is dropping very slowly. So as we make this line longer, it takes more fall, and then you almost get to it.
We're not proposing to use it.
I'm going to move this thing.
Y'all, we seem to be breaking into different groups, and we're fine to do that. If we want to make the meeting officially over, we'll hang around and answer as many questions as y'all have. But if you've got group questions, let's answer those, and then we'll stay as long as you like and answer those, because I know some of y'all came in late, and I apologize. Staff wasn't even able to open the room, so we're having to make do out here. So does anybody have any other group questions?
Did you have
questions?
Anything prepared? You said you had some conditions.
We do.
You
we do.
Maybe offer.
And what I can do is we can send y'all an email of them. A bunch of them flew away here. What we can agree to is a minimum 2,500 square foot homes, exclusive of garages, and that's heated floor space. That doesn't count decks and porches and all those other things.
What size?
2,500 minimum. It's got standard conditions saying that we'd have a homeowners association monument type sign. All the open space has to be maintained by the homeowners association. As far as facades go, we have done this multiple ways, but what we want to try to do is not make a cookie cutter house. So the latest draft of what we've been working with folks say at least 45% of the houses have to have at least 75% brick or stone on the fronts, and then the other 25% could be something like cedar shake, something hardy board, no vinyl would be allowed. Another 45% could have up to 50% with a brick or stone, and then you could have the hardy board, and then you could have up to 10% that could be, say, all siding. We've done it multiple ways where we've said 100% of the houses have to have 75% masonry fronts, but as I told you, I think Westbrook is one of the most architecturally interesting neighborhoods in the county, and it's because you don't have this regimented, each house has to make look alike type of condition. So that's what we were trying to model when we came up with this. I'll send these out to y'all, and if you have any suggestions of how we can improve it, we're certainly open to that.
a requirement for a brick or stone water table around the side and the base of the property. Water table similar to these the stone bottoms on this neighborhood. That's what we're referring to. Requirement maximum reveal of 6 inches on any kind of lap siding so that you don't have the big wide 50s type paneling.
Oh my god, I missed that.
Austin.
Let's see.
Sure.
A provision that said we'd only grade where necessary for road, utility, home site, and amenity construction. The intention is to, again, not just come in, just slick it down, preserve everything we can. Sidewalks on one side of the street. Agreed to the traffic signpost would be wooden, so you don't just have the metal. You'd actually try to build into it architecturally. And agreed to a 25-foot exterior buffer along Westbrook. So that's what we're proposing. I'll email these out.
What was the last one?
25-foot, a 25-foot vegetative buffer along the boundary with Westbrook.
So what do we?
Trees down. They're gonna put back.
So you're talking.
How does this not get washed away? Yes.
How does it not get washed away?
So in the area that I'm, of course, talking about.
We can plant. Richard, I think you were saying we have to leave the slopes at 2:1.
We can't do anything steeper than 2:1. So if it's existing, if it's very steep, we really don't want to touch it.
But you can plant a 2:1 slope with landscape.
Sure.
So vegetative buffer. That's pretty broad.
You can plant a sheer.
Can we stipulate the type of or the types of trees?
What I'll do is the county has, and what it says is the Forsyth County buffer standards. The county has a list of trees that it has approved, and when it does buffer, it requires a minimum of overstory trees, midstory trees, and shrubs. I'll email those to you, but what they require is you have to have at least three different types, because they don't want you in one row and then get a blight and wipe out the whole buffer. So I'll email the buffer standards to you, and you can take a look at those. If y'all want to pick specific trees, we're open to talking about those.
Two things that were mentioned last week, at the last meeting, excuse me. Was
guard for me.
The young lady over here. Was the architectural shingles, the 3D shingles, and the chimney, the full metal chimney shrouds.
The chimney shrouds.
I just wanted to bring that up.
That'd be a problem. We're talking
about chimney shrouds.
Chimney shrouds are fine with an architectural shingle. We can add that.
So minimum 2,500 square foot. Mm-hmm. That's already sized to accommodate that.
These are, well, that's two stories. That's the heated square footage. Right. These are a little bit smaller.
This is not the house size. This is just
the plan. Are the lots already sized to accommodate then?
Oh,
the lot. Yeah. Absolutely.
How many lots are proposed? 24. So 24 homes.
Minimum. The lot, minimum. Yeah, they're minimum 10,000.
You're allocating an acre for lot.
Which is,
per foot minimum. I end up with five homes.
A quarter acre.
Six, seven, eight.
There's 24 homes. And I'm going to have five of those homes in the process.
Where are you at?
I'm on 38.
So you're only going to have one that's going to propose.
One, two, three, four, five.
So if you're taking it, if you're going to look at it like that, how many homes
are you looking at? Like that, or looking at it out my back window like that.
Okay. If you look at it in that respect, then yeah, maybe five homes behind it.
I'm really confused about this part right here.
Okay.
So have y'all done detailed analysis of why you can't take the original route of the easement? You've chosen to go this route, right?
Correct.
Because it's the least expensive and most direct.
Correct.
So what has been done, detailed analysis, what has been done to say why you can't take what you already have? The only part you've got in now is an easement that goes all the way back here, right?
That's recorded, correct.
So, right. So you've determined based on price and convenience to go this route. So I think the community would like to know what gives you, why would you go away from the original, the county is giving you the right to go right across here.
Okay.
I know it's more expensive. But I'd like to see something that says what has been done to say why you're going this route.
Has the sewer easement been acquired? I thought the only sewer easement that's been acquired is on the plat, so we know where we're punching through.
Well, no. there's been, through Westbrook, this county gave a permanent 50-foot, or excuse me, a permanent 20-foot sanitary sewer easement, okay? And a 50-foot sanitary construction easement. This comes over, ties into the back of this line.
Is it on the meadow? I'm sorry, is it across, just for a while now, is it, this is what we call our little meadow here?
Yes.
So it's all the way around the back side of that meadow?
Correct.
And connects way over here?
Here's the location.
Okay, so it connects on Lowell Court?
Correct. And here's our proposed development over here.
Okay.
So, rather than disturb all of that floodplain, come through this area that you...
The meadow's behind that.
No. No. Well, you're right. You're right. I'm sorry. You're right. But they go, but they're going to get to that. The meadow, everything where's your line? Everything from here back is the meadow.
So this is the meadow right back, like here.
And their current easement goes across here, right?
Correct.
Across the meadow.
It's going to take off on this side of the creek.
Okay. This side of the creek goes straight across the meadow and connects back behind Lowell Court. So I'm very curious to see what studies have been done, other than just convenience and price. Why have you chosen to go and come up here and connect into this part?
There's been no studies done on it.
Wouldn't you think there would be?
Well, we're disturbing less floodplain, we know that. That'd be one less study that we would have to provide to show that we're not disturbing more. The proposed? We don't have a proposed. There is a tie in this direction right here, showing that the shortest route for us to get there is to this main line.
Well, I hear it's the shortest route. Can't take that. Sure. But it also affects even more homes here. When what you've got is an easement that goes along here.
Well, so do we affect homes or do we affect floodplain? Because this really doesn't affect any homes.
Well, that's kind of an interesting. That's kind of disingenuous because the whole thing you're affecting floodplain. Now you're concerned about floodplain.
The sewer says we can go through the floodplain. That's the difference.
But in either case, you're affecting floodplain. So let's don't look at it and say,
this way we affect no floodplain. Their way that they want you to go, we affect the entire thing is in the floodplain.
But you're coming across property that is...
So you would prefer us to go through the floodplain?
No, what I'd like to do, what I prefer, is to have a study that shows why you're doing this and what at every step, what are you doing to the water table? What's the impact of the runoff? And we've talked about it, but we've got nothing that says you're even doing that.
And we've done that.
Fantastic. Okay,
done
good. That. Okay. We'd like to see that.
Okay.
Good. But I still would like to see what kind of, so it's just purely, you really want to protect the floodplain. That's why you're going across this way, not this way.
I was unaware that, honestly, I was unaware of this easement coming through the floodplain down here. When I did the analysis of this, there were two sewer tie-in points here that worked out best for us. And there was, when I looked at GIS to see the best tie-in points, there was nothing else even on the radar over here or over there.
Would it be fair to say that if you had to go this route, would it be so expensive that you have to look at this a little bit more? Or is that one of the reasons you're having to go across this?
If there's something over here, yeah, we will entertain anything we can to make the best design.
But it really drives your costs up, doesn't it?
That would be more expensive if we had to cut through the floodplain, do more permitting, knock down more trees. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that could be more expensive.
I think if the county's already got a direction that was in place before y'all started, that'd be the way to go.
Okay, so you're asking us to use the existing sewer easement.
Okay.
Don't cut up next to the...
And the county staff asked us to do this.
Okay. So. And I thought one of the concerns out here in both developments is, hey, you know, don't affect the floodplain. Don't do anything to the floodplain. So,
well,
I mean, that right there is totally out of it. You know, now we're going to...
Let's not argue, because it's legitimate, because I think what I'm hearing is... You guys are concerned about trees coming down. And you're concerned about now we've got a sewer easement, the trees got to come down. Is that right?
20 feet.
Okay, so if we can avoid that, if it's possible, then let's talk about how we can do it.
I think just look at what the county had originally designed. And then y'all just kind of do your analysis and let us know what it is.
Is that something that might sell y'all on the development?
I think y'all need to do that first.
Well, I mean, I'm with you. We're willing to work with y'all, but let's just put our cards on the table. If everybody's going to say, we want you to do this, and we agree to do all this, and then you still come out and fight us, you know, it needs to be a give and take. And that's what we're trying to ask y'all. We'll give if y'all will give.
And I understand that, and I appreciate that, but I also think that if you already have a route in place before you even start it, I think it's important to at least let us know the scenario of that route versus what you're proposing.
Understand.
I think that's fine.
Just another comment on that. If we do go and use the county's route, don't you guys have trails and access and stuff back through there?
We have the meadow.
That'll be cut off during construction.
just FYI.
And that's fine.
When that goes through.
And that's fine.
Okay. Right here, this would not cut off anything to anybody at any time.
But basically, once you go through the meadow, you'll
the pedestrian easement's actually right here.
No, the pedestrian easement is on over here.
No.
That's my lot right here. I live there every day.
Okay.
All right, so we'll definitely take a look at it. And I was unaware that was here, and that's sometimes you do a development, they want to see an upstream easement to the next guy, and that's one that, even if it doesn't work, they force you to do that. Right. Unless you are the farthest upstream, in this case we would be, so there would be nobody else for us to bring a sewer easement to. And now they want you to go away from the easement and actually provide the physical manhole. And that's probably one where somebody was just checking off a comment, but we'll certainly look at that.
Okay.
If that works out easier for everybody, absolutely.
Okay.
And I think, too, a lot of the concerns, and it goes back to the water thing, because y'all are changing the whole face of it, of this property. And that's why we're all kind of, you know, you're saying that they don't do the hydro study before they determine the zoning.
Correct.
Or they'll change the zoning?
Mm-hmm.
The detail.
Do they do an initial one?
Yeah, here's the initial one right here.
Okay. Okay.
This is, I don't know if I can do a quick explanation of this. Right now, all the water is running this way. And we're going to capture as much as we can in the street, send it to this pond. And this pond, by code, has to provide three things: water quality, child protection, and stormwater detention. The water quality number, that's the big one. That's saying, okay, if you're disturbing X amount, you've got to capture and treat X amount. And you hold that water for 24 hours and slowly release it, and that settles out any impurities. The county has what's called a TSS, or Stormwater Quality Performance Review Form. Without doing any ponds, well, their requirement is 65 pounds per acre per year. That's how much sediment can run off the site. That's their limit. So right here is that dashed line. Without doing any ponds on site whatsoever, this proposed development meets the criteria. So according to that, we don't have to do a pond.
But detention, this?
Right. We don't even have to put that in according to what the county has. But we are putting it in anyway. And then that's where our number is. We've got to be below this dashed line, and that's where we are with BMP, the best management practices there. This is a breakdown of these areas, what's going to the pond, what's not. So all this runoff that's coming to this area, we're going to capture what we're disturbing, most of it anyway, about 75% of it, send it to the pond, the rest to be bypassed. So we're reducing the basin that's running straight down, mm-hmm. So this runoff will be less. And then the runoff that we are capturing comes here and sits for 24 hours and then is slowly released. So we're helping what we're capturing and we're helping what we're not.
Okay.
So if you were to analyze this at any point, we're improving it or we're matching the existing conditions.
And given that
sure.
statement,
mm-hmm. yeah.
we see, I guess because you know, we're there, we
correct.
See the water pretty much
yeah.
stand pretty uh-huh. wide yep. along that run.
Especially here, that's a swampy area.
So that's our concern. Mm-hmm. You know, as you get further down, you know, because we've seen a lot of water, so you're saying basically you're going to improve it to the point to where you're going to run the water controlled to there.
Forsyth County makes you meet your pre-developed flow rates plus another 10%. So you'll actually see this water go down just a little bit. So it will be slightly drier after we get through the development.
Okay, so they do the flow rates before you do anything.
Mm-hmm. You have water quality, which cleans it. You have channel protection, which protects against erosion. And then you have peak flow detention. And that's your big storm events that comes
right.
through. And that we have to analyze what's on site where we're disturbing, and also what's called a 10% study, in which our site is only 10% of the overall basin. So we're 25 acres, so we'll look at a 250-acre basin and make sure we're not disturbing anything about it. And that's by code. That's state recommended and county required. So we would have to hit that just to get a permit. But this shows that from a water quality standpoint, we don't even need a pond. So this will be grossly over-designed as far as stormwater goes. Just by putting in a pond at all.
Yes, sir. There is over the 26, 25 acres, though, isn't it? It's 20, not over just that area there, right?
25.04. What we do
right,
is.
Right, it's just not concentrated in that area there. That's over the 25 acres.
You mean the study is done?
We're not worried about the other acreage. We're
right.
worried about this acreage right,
right
here.
Right. This post-development will match pre-developed. This area post-development will exceed pre-developed by code. So this will be, if you were to do, we'll have a monitoring station set up here near construction. Where it leaves the site, this would be cleaner once we're done than before we start, by code.
But part of the study is to do it before you do anything, to get the base level, whatever.
Yes. And if we were to touch this, if we had to disturb it, they would make us do a flood study to prove we weren't adversely affecting anything. So it's either stay out of it, or if you touch it, do a study to prove that you're not hurting it.
Or replace whatever you screw up.
I'd like to go back to one of the original questions. Sure. Of we're having this second meeting not because the layout is changed, but only because someone decided that we didn't see enough of this area up here. Is that correct?
No, we like to have as many meetings with folks as we can. It gives us an opportunity to get more feedback. If y'all want to have another meeting, we're up for that too.
The county required as part of the application a survey showing everything, okay, and then the engineered plan. So what we did was we gave them the full a boundary survey showing the whole site, and then I just printed out what we were doing here and blew it up to a larger scale. And they said, no, we want to see everything on the engineer drawing. Even though we're not touching this, they made us go back and redraw it and change the scale. So that's all this was. I try to use the largest scale possible. That way it's the cleanest you see the most. It's not all crammed in there, but they made us go back and change it, which is also why this is on the larger sheet.
I missed the first one, I'm sorry, this may have covered. Was there any consideration to a different zoning, like in R2R or Res2 or something, a little bigger lots and less houses, or was that?
It's just not feasible. R2R is a defunct zoning category.
Or some other,
you can't get it. Res2 is the closest, but it requires 100-foot wide lots, and candidly, it does. The financial model doesn't work. Y'all don't have 100-foot wide lots, so we're looking for something that's comparable.
I just know there's been a lot of buzz in Forsyth County about Res3, and
people
reduced the buffers to try to encourage growth, and now we got 8 million houses going to get built in the next year, but I'm just curious how
the difference, it's some folks get real caught up on lot size, and some folks get caught up on density. The density will come in as less than one house to the acre, but the lot size, they're smaller lot sizes.
It's really 7 acres.
And we're talking about increasing the minimum lot size of R3, has that happened yet? Would this be a grandfathered case if they don't do it before y'all?
It would be, even if they did it tomorrow, it would be a grandfathered case. Okay. What do y'all have something, what do y'all have in mind?
I was just curious. I knew they were making the change and I didn't know how it would work.
If it's something that y'all would be willing to say, okay, we could go along with that, let's talk about lot size. Let's talk about minimum lot size.
Just
don't build this on the street.
You want one big lot?
No, we want trees. We want trees.
Okay.
That's, you asked for a question. There's
that word till I drink it down.
Yeah,
that's
right. Yeah, you took all the weight out of it.
Yeah, so, I mean, on average, you're saying that lot size is around a quarter of an acre right now, right? I mean,
75 feet wide.
So, give or take.
10,000 minimum, so yeah, quarter acre, you're right.
Give or take. And I mean, there's 24, right? Yes. Did I get that right?
Yes.
I mean, at what point, like, because we have, we're talking maybe 4 acres, but if we take in, if it goes down to 23 homes because of that, at what point becomes it unfeasible for you guys? That's what I'm trying to.
I candidly don't know the answer.
I mean, because it's a small subdivision as it is.
It is. And that gets back to, I think, this gentleman's question about amenities. It's so small, no, there's not going to be any active amenities, like a swim pool or a tennis court.
But you got lots of room. You could make a walking path or a meadow. Right?
Well, walking paths are feasible. The county prohibits building in a floodplain, so you can't build it. But you could put amenity areas, or like a gazebo or a pavilion or something like that.
We'd like to look at nice houses. We want to make sure they sell for high value.
Sure.
What things you can put in there. You know, I thought saw an original estimated price for house, but I mean that can't be a condition.
No, and that's what we try to address with square footage and amenities. That's not a bad thing. Let's go back and look at that.
How many times does the from what I heard, and maybe this is wrong, I'm just curious. That very rarely does the original plan actually be what was built. I know that wasn't the case with Westbrook.
We're actually pretty constrained there. There's not many ways it can change. We just put a road right down the middle. We match the existing topo as much as we can, and then double load the street.
The conditions are going to kind of control that. What they put on us that time of zoning, all these stipulations on lot sizes, house size.
But from an engine, I'm talking from
you don't know. You may get in there and there's a granite quarry, yeah, smack in the middle of it. Yeah, right. And that's just a risk you take in the development business.
And anyway, the cost, is it worth busting out all this rock to put in one house, or is it worth building this retaining wall in this area? I mean, they face these questions
that,
all the time.
And that is, I do worry about that, because this is complex. I mean, you got probably rock, you got a lot of timber, you got a lot of grading. So you got to have a lot of things go right on budget.
There's a lot of moving parts. I mean, we do this every day. There's a lot of moving parts, and Forsyth County is very strict, especially on the stormwater requirements. Like I said, they make you go 10% beyond, and they're very strict on the tree recompense. I mean, cutting down one tree really costs you. So we try not to do any of that that we don't have to.
Is this developer properly bonded, if that's the right terminology, so that if something were to happen and he just walked away and left this massive scar on the land?
He would be forced to by the county.
What if they go bankrupt?
There's an erosion control bond. Well, he'll have to put that up front before he gets his permit. Mm.
We've seen those already.
And it's a big dollar now.
Does he have other developments that we can look at?
He's built
this would be for his first development.
All of his homes before were
custom. A lot of houses,
yeah, he's custom homes, saddle up scattered all over. He does a lot in St. Marlo. He's got a couple in Sugar Loaf.
Very nice. Very high end. Yep.
This is be his first development.
When is the, I know it's a couple of phases away, but when is this portion of Castleberry, I mean Bethelview,
hoped
to be
coincide
to be expanded?
Bethelview, the plans haven't even been approved yet, so I don't know the exact construction date.
Will we be guaranteed a curb median break?
Yeah.
Since there's an entrance over here to Ashbrook?
One of the comments that we received preliminarily from the county was that we have to provide a decel lane, depending on when the phases of construction take place. So yeah, we have to provide, our developer has to provide that.
That'll all be done in coordination with their improvements.
There's
no median break here, that people are going to come down to our neighborhood to do a U-turn.
It would be something we would try to play for with the DOT plans.
Staff would have commented on that. They would have told us to change our plans to take that out. Staff's already reviewed this.
They asked for it to line up.
Okay, yeah, but so because it lines up with Ashbrook, there's very likely going to be a median break.
We have to line up with Brock. We don't have enough room.
Yeah, well,
I mean, either you line up or you miss it by 150 feet or so. That way, there's cars aren't running into each other. So we'll have to line up.
But at the time these DOT plans were done, you know, they don't know that we're going to have a development here. So, right. But these are still very preliminary as well for both of you.
Yeah, they're going to finish the first part first, right?
They're actually acquiring right-of-way. If you know, like Polo, on that south of Kelly Mill, they're acquiring right-of-way now.
To answer your question,
hopefully that'll be moving the next year.
Well,
they were saying it's 5 years for the whole thing.
Oh, okay.
Here's us right here. There's already a proposed break in the median. So, well, proposed. Here's the median. Here's North Ridge. Mm-hmm. There'll be something already proposed.
What's the median?
Yes.
That's
your question.
Because we're going to figure this out too. Some may say something about this now because they already know about this here.
I'm sorry.
They already know they're widening the road here because they're already talking about it right here.
Sure.
So why didn't they catch this here when they looked at the plans of the county?
They didn't need it. This was going to be required regardless. They didn't need this. I'm talking about the DOT. That's their plan. It's not us. They're the ones.
Y'all had. If y'all like, we've done this in the past. We can meet with y'all, or if y'all want to meet separately, but I'd recommend that you call Renee Ho. She's the county engineer. If I want to write her number down, I'll give it to you. So I throw her under the bus here on video. It's 770-781-2165.
Renee Hogue.
Hogue, H-O-G-E. Yeah, don't trust us. Don't believe us, what we're telling you. Verify it. Yeah, we're trustworthy people. I promise we'll tell you the truth, even if you don't like it. But, you know, verify it with the county.
I think last time we talked about a fence,
mm-hmm.
Was that on your list? Did you mention that?
A fence? What kind?
Fence along
It was not on the list. What when we talked
I
about?
I think it was still just kind of an open item as to what type of fence would look best, whether it's a rail fence or.
Were you talking about a privacy fence between the two properties?
Not necessarily a privacy fence, but I mean
a fence between the two properties. Yes, going along the line.
Let me ask you: do you want to see a fence, or do you just want to know a fence is there?
There's a 10-foot right here, so that pedestrian access.
I mean, I don't know what would look best.
We would prefer not to destroy the property line, just to install it. But we can put several different types of fences in if you want.
I think what we was talking about before was having a meeting with the HOA just to say, you know, can we have some input if there is a fence that's put up? We're not saying we want a fence, but if there is a fence, or I don't know that we may be saying we want one, but I'm sorry, you mean a fence, like if I own this house and I want a fence in my backyard for my dog?
No. Look at that fence. Just a property dividing fence.
And when they built Westbrook on the other side, they put there's a pasture that Nevin changed, but they put a privacy fence along that property. Along the whole section.
And blown
okay, we're not necessarily saying we want one. Right. We just would say if
thank
that
you.
Comes to that.
Thank you for being flexible.
Like we've done that before.
We're expecting the key not be where it's supposed to be.
Instead of putting in a tree buffer, vegetative buffer, we'll put in a privacy fence. We would rather leave the trees there. Because you have to tear down trees to put in.
I think everybody's in agreement that we want to keep the trees.
Sure.
That is our top. If we do anything for less, we want to keep the trees.
Okay.
Yeah, at the same time, though, I think a landscape buffer is a good option because, I mean, once the homeowner owns the house, if he sees trees, he wants to remove them. I mean, I just know those trees, a lot of those trees are kind of falling over.
And did you say that they would be 3 stories high like some of ours? Would they be right on even with it?
I'm wondering what these filling.
I'd like to be above.
Well, I used to have a nice little walkway.
You like to? I'm sorry. You like the trees to be above the house?
No, we like to be above these houses that are coming in.
I think you will be just topographically. Isn't everything in Westbrook going to be at a higher elevation?
It would take a very tall house.
Very
tall. Yeah, I think that's great.
If you have the 25-foot buffer, we're talking about that.
Y'all forgive me. We're breaking up again, and I'm not trying to run everything, but I want to make us talk about it. We can't answer your questions, so I can't.
If you then forget, finish yours.
Yeah. If we have the 25-foot buffer, what happened? Like, does the homeowner purchase it as his land? Right. What happens
there's,
at that?
There's
point?
Ways we've done that, but again, that gets into the lot size issue. We have made those buffer areas part of the HOA's property, and therefore it's not owned by a lot owner, and that way they don't get into it. But when you do that, you get smaller lots. So it all comes down to how big a lot are you looking for on it. But that's one of the ways we've escaped that. Otherwise, what we do is we handle it with covenants. We just put a covenant in the declaration for the HOA that says you have a 25-foot buffer, you're liable for any encroachments into it.
I've got a two-part question, kind of going along that. Are these homes going to be at the? Is this home going to be the same sight line level as this home, or will there be maybe 30 or 40 foot difference between the right side of the street
down.
To the
these
left?
These would have basements.
Okay.
And then these are simple but higher. Probably what we're going to have, we'll tie into the grade as quick as we can. We'll have the road sitting here, one driveway may be coming up at 10%, the other going down at 10%.
Okay.
And that sets where the garage levels are, the finished floor 2 feet above that. And then this would have the basement, this would.
Okay, so on the 25 foot buffer, is that 25 on a vertical plane? I mean, on a horizontal plane?
That's correct.
Okay. Linear buffer. So it could be 25 straight down, it'd only be 10 feet.
Linear buffer.
Okay.
If there were a cliff there,
I don't speak engineers.
Okay, I see where you're going. Yeah. You don't want a 25.
Is it the hypotenuse
like
or the?
Yeah, not the hypotenuse. The
straight up.
You mentioned 2,500 square feet. Is that? Are we? I'm assuming there's no ranches for given this property size. Or are you?
You might get one. Some folks come in who are, empty nesters. They don't want a yard to maintain. They want something smaller. They might want a master on main. That's a possibility.
It'll fit in that plan.
It might. Yeah, I mean, maybe here. We're kind of considering all these two-story. This is, and like I said, this is all just, these are rectangles we just...
Yeah, no, that's why I'm asking, right. I mean, because I know they're not exactly to scale.
Well, I think it was a tell that most of the side on this side is not going to have basements.
Yeah, that's why I asked the next question.
Yeah.
think, frankly, I mean, I don't think you're not going to have a fence that we're going to have a branch on that that's going to be economical for them to even do it without making two stories. It's not going to make sense.
And we definitely want y'all to address the existing sewer.
We'll look at that.
So, thank you.
Do y'all want to cover floodplain?
Well, I mean, I think it goes back to when you change everything, how is it going to affect the floodplain?
Well, this, again, talk to the county. I mean, verify what we're telling you, but we're in the North Georgia, North Metro Water Planning District. We're not in the ARC, so we have a different set of rules than maybe down in Sandy Springs. But you can't, Forsyth County prohibits you to build in a floodplain. You can't build in it, at least not a residence. But there's no buffer from it. So you can, you know, the floodplain's here, you can literally put the foundation next to it. There is a stream that runs through the floodplain, and you have buffers off of that. The floodplain so far exceeds the stream buffer. I mean, it's, you're not going to have a house within 75 feet.
I guess I've seen floodplains move, you know, just because of development. I mean, I've seen a house 10 years previously was in a floodplain. You know, development around it all, so everything's redrawn and
the streams move. Yeah, especially in property lines that follow sea lines of streams.
Yeah. So then you know.
I guess that's the concern too. I mean, we know there's a lot of floodplain back there, and we know it can move. And then I keep asking this, but when you're doing a sewer and the water tables are high. That's pretty common.
You use an iron pipe. You use a duct iron pipe if you have moisture problems. But all the manholes are sealed tight. Yeah. You could put them underwater.
So
oh, really?
The size is there. I remember you asking the questions last time about what happens if something breaks. I mean, of course, nobody wants anything to happen. But yeah, I mean, they're development ready on these types of. You're not going to be able to get a plastic pipe underwater. It could be a steel pipe. I mean, it's heavily inspected when it's installed.
So repeat that. You said that if it's in floodplain, you have to use.
If there's a moisture problem, if there's field, if the depth is too shallow, too.
But did you say you have to use ductile iron pipe in a floodplain?
In a floodplain, I don't know if there's moisture issues. Okay. We would usually use ductile iron. Just because it's in a floodplain doesn't mean. If it's in a studied floodplain, that doesn't necessarily mean there is a water issue.
Right, but if you have high water tables.
If you had that, right.
And that's
or if they hit that, out in the field, yeah, they can change that on the fly if they need to make it stronger.
But shouldn't the water study define all of that? Will the water study that you're talking about, the hydro study, is that what it's called?
The hydro study studies water as it hits our site and runs down.
So is there anything?
The floodplain.
Is there
like
anything
the
that defines
study?
That?
No. The hydro study studies water as it runs down.
Right.
The flood study studies it kind of as it backs up.
Okay.
So if a big flood came through and the water swelled up 3 days later, as it comes up like this, how far does it reach? So the hydro is more like moving water coming down.
Right. And where it's going.
Right.
So nobody really looks at the water tables.
Now when they build the houses, when they put footings in, when they do retaining walls, they're building septic fields, any kind of soil like that, they'll dig down and see, check the water tables, soil types, things like that. But that's not required for general purpose.
For sewer.
They may look at it when they're laying bedding or something before a pipe. They may look at moisture problems and that changes the type of bedding. They use things like that. They'll do that in the field.
Thank y'all for coming out. We'll email the materials to you. We really do want to have a dialogue. We hadn't heard from anybody. We sent out an email or two and hadn't heard back. So I hope that we can try to work together.
Yeah, you get the site plan was good. That was real detailed.
So we'll get you anything. Like I said, we want to try to work with you.
Do you have specific questions about those easements, where they come?
I just want to see that.
Send me the email.
I'll send. What was your first name again?
Taylor.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll send out. Address. Our whole team will have our email addresses when we send out.
I'll do that.
Okay.
But to me, it just seems like, you know, we talked about this, to give that person the right to sell their land, to fit 24 houses on 6 acres, essentially, and kill all these trees and knock them all down to do it. Just seems like a really tight project for a brand new developer. You know, I know you guys talked a lot about technical stuff. That's just how I feel. And
Well, I mean, he's not going to be out there running the grader himself. And I understand. It's a lot easier to pay, say, hey, I did this development, I did this subdivision. This is his first go, but he's going to be held to the same standards as people have been doing it for 30 years. And the county responds pretty quickly to some of the calls. But we're happy. We've worked with neighborhoods, and we said, hey, you know, before we get a permit, we'll send you a copy of it, let you see, you know, take a look at it, make sure that it's what we told you it was going to be. So we're happy to do that. This is not something we're just trying to come in there and make y'all's lives miserable. We want to work with you and be good neighbors.
What would have been the route to develop this if this 60% of this land could not have been rezoned as Res 3? If it just had to be left since it was floodplain, unbuildable now, unbuildable later, what would have been the way to get this done?
I'm trying to think of the acreage of that.
That's 7 acres. 24 houses, 7 acres.
3.5. Yeah, I mean, you couldn't. In theory, you could ask for a Res 4. Could we get it approved? No. But in theory, you could ask for it. But that's not what's going to be there. But again, fortunately, this is how the county counts. Fortunately or unfortunately, however you look at it. But that's
we want
how
to
the
divide
county
that
counts.
Piece that's right next to it rather than the floodplain and then move the houses a little off the trees.
Do you, what,
this one here?
Yeah.
Is it public record yet what this contract amount is for this, not, you know, for this parcel of land?
It will never be public record. The only way you could ever tell what somebody pays for it is you look at the transfer tax on the deed. So, but it's not something we'll ever make as public record. But again, this I don't want it to be confused that this is a Res 4. This is a Res 3 development. We're asking minimum 10,000 square foot lots on it.
10,000?
Minimum.
Well, what's the maximum? What's the, you know, this one looks like it's a big one. Oh, 1080. Okay, they're listed. Here we go. Okay. 11,000.
They don't have to follow that.
Right.
Exactly.
They're just saying 10,000.
Yeah. They're drawn pretty close to 10,000. I mean, you got some of the big ones out here, but they're outliers. Right. But they're pretty close. Here's an 11,000.
They're all over 10. Yeah. The rectangle ones are a little bit tighter.
15,000,
11. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there's probably a little bigger. What's going to be the kind of the max price point? Has he talked about that? I mean, I know someone can get crazy and do what they want for the house, but what has that been discussed?
No idea, honestly. I mean,
the market will kind of grow.
Right, but I mean, the builder can also go.
So that's where we went to facade.
350s.
Hey, 250s. If someone were to come in and say, you know what? There is just this huge market demand for million-dollar houses, right, and this is the place. I guarantee any developer who says, hey, I can make money on the deal, I'm in on it.
Right.
But
okay, better said than what?
But there aren't million-dollar houses. You know, it's just not.
I'm not asking for someone for million-dollar houses. I'm not asking. I'm just.
But you want to know what these houses might sell for.
That's it's probably going to be start in the low threes, go to mid fours. What is Westbrook now, y'all? For a while, y'all were fives and sixes.
What it is now, what it started out, are two different things. Yeah. So it's even now, it's five plus.
Is
most,
it?
Most of the houses are okay. Wire homes, the future homes.
So. See, I thought I saw a sign that says from the threes. But
that's just to get you to drive in.
It literally is.
That was 2009 right there.
Honestly, that's good to hear. That's great to hear.
Well, you said you were open to, we could talk about some of the facades if we wanted to.
Absolutely.
Have some
I'm going to email you. It is a admittedly complicated zoning condition, so take a look at it. If y'all got some suggestions to improve it, let's do it. But what we want to try to do is require high quality facades, but not force a cookie cutter product where every house looks alike.
Sure. It would be nice to get a list from the developer, some of his homes that we can drive by,
okay,
that he deems representative.
Okay.
That'd be nice.
Or he just may not have built these. If he's built in St. Marlow and Sugarloaf and all those, he's
built in the lower question too.
But it's not unreasonable to ask for a
representative.
Ask for
I've got it in my notes, so we'll get on. Yeah. Get on. Well, thank y'all, and again, thank you for being flexible. I apologize problem trying to get the key to the rec center. Do y'all have any other questions?
Nope.
I don't mean to keep beating a dead horse, but if I could see the actual route that was originally in place.
I can.
Okay.
I can make you an exhibit of that prepared.
Okay. We'll email that and those materials, Steve.
Okay. Yeah, thanks.
Thank y'all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ma'am, thank you for hanging with us.
Thanks, man.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, guys.
Thank y'all.
Nice
to
see you.
Yeah.
Nice to see you.
No,
those are
all yours.
Okay. Oh yeah?
No.
Oh.
I'm glad people
are
asking
good
questions,
but that's
all right.
Yeah. Thanks, I'll see you guys.
Behind your house, will it be level? Will it be up? Will it be down?
Yeah.
We'll be looking at it.
Are there any places
upstairs windows over
time? We're going to go to the 2-1 unless it's yours. If it works, they're not going to touch it.
I love to see that because I have a room. Can I give you my room? Yeah.
Are there any spots at all where they
touch the lower of each other's room?
Oh, he's at ARC.
Oh, yes.
It's right
there.
You've got, but what is it? The ARC is Atlanta, right? Yeah. Lowry's in commission? That's only 7 acres? That's 7 acres or 8 acres? Or 7 miles or 8 acres? 8 miles up from that one.
But I thought we talked about last time that you were here. That you figured out.
I'm right on the floor. Most of the city lights in the spring.
The only place we've got that 150-foot buffer, like we talked about, is within a water supply intake, and that's the Roswell one. So there's, you get down far
on
the
road,
there's a portion in the county that's very, very, very far south, far on there, that has that larger buffer. But up here is 57.
If you'll let me give me some information, I'll look into it. Okay.
I was going to ask, did you have your first weed eating here? You got the scars.
Oh, you know what? I talked about it years ago. Would you need to move hydrangea bushes? And I've moved them twice now, and I will never tell her again. We started with 5. We're now, they grow so big, I had to move everything. So they attacked me. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Well, they need no picture. On a good note, we can get our money back for Britain.
Okay.
Thanks
for coming
right
out.
Yeah.